I think it works itself out higher. I think we closed the year higher than we are today, and I think 2019 ends up being a pretty good year for equities as well. And I think the main issue that we're dealing with is a sentiment problem, not a fundamental problem. And when people look at equity markets, I think one of the mistakes that they make is they think, oh, the equities must be signaling something about the economy, but stocks aren't very good on the economy. You know, when you're investing in stocks, you're investing in future profits, and as a result, stocks end up becoming more tuned to a profit cycle versus an economic cycle. And they work at different speeds. So when looking at an economic cycle, I think it's important to look at credit markets. And what's been really unique about this pullback that started at the end of September is that it was equities that led credit lower. It's sort of like the tail wagging the dog. And that tells me it's more sentiment related rather than fundamental.
And it can be sentiment, which is nothing can change. And I don't know whether something did change in the fundamentals, because you always worry that's what you're signaling as a mm-hmm. discounting mechanism yep. with the stock market. But sometimes it can be just complacency or you know, bullishness gets, you know, up at those really high levels yep. of sentiment. I mean, we used to watch a percentage of investment services bearish or bullish. So it's weird that it may have nothing to do with the fundamentals. It just the market needs a correction, needs to wring out some complacency. That makes it very hard to decide what's happening, doesn't it? You got to tune out the noise.
Yeah, that's important, and turn off emotion. More than noise, emotion. Sentiment, as you call it. And I think, basically, I agree with what's being said, that you know, most likely in the base case, markets trade up. And I think what markets are trying to do is to resolve two forces. One force that's pulling markets up is valuation. The forces that are pulling the market down and that also pull down sentiment are basically idiosyncratic as opposed to systemic risks. And the idiosyncratic risks that we have faced since late last year have been policy in the US, trade policy, pro-cyclical fiscal policy, Federal Reserve policy, across the pond, fiscal policy, Italy, France, residual risk of Brexit, and across in Asia, a Chinese slowdown, which is, given demographics, sort of inevitable.
Right, but as far as data points with the tariffs, or as far as data points with sentiment or actual, mm-hmm. a harming trade with the UK because of the pending Brexit, whatever you're talking about, are those real things that we can see data points on? Do we see some numbers being hurt by these extraneous factors, or is it still just worries about the unknown, or how bad it's going to be?
They can be hurt. I mean, if you go back to, let's say, 13, 14 years ago, you had 8% S&P margins. Today, you're about 12%. Almost all the move can be explained by globalization, right?
If we pull back on that, we go back below 12.
Exactly. I mean, so it's not the immediate impact of tariffs on $459 billion out of an 18 trillion economy that we should be concerned about. It's the impact on margins and the impact on investment. And when I say idiosyncratic risks, I'm not trying to belittle the risks. What I'm trying to say is these are risks of choice, policy choice, and just as one can choose to be, not agree with people, you can also choose to agree. And I think the sort of discussions we're having this morning, since the pain is being felt everywhere, people come back to the table.
God forbid we have more pain than 10-12%. I mean, markets do go down 20-25%.
I don't see that. And what the markets are signaling is that there's a recession coming up in 2019 or 2020. But when you ask about data points, think about the data points we're looking at. In September of this year, before the markets pulled back, we were looking at earnings growth that was going to slow and a 10-year treasury at 3.25%. Today, we're looking at earnings growth that's still going to slow, and a 10-year treasury, it sits at about 285. Yeah. Those lower rates are actually good for valuation. And on top of that, think about the underlying fundamentals. 68% of the U.S. economy is the consumer, and the consumer between record jobs markets, tax cuts, and now falling gas prices, the consumer is actually ending up with a lot of money back in his or her wallet. Gas prices fell 50 cents a gallon from the May peak to today, and that puts an average of about $250 back in a person's wallet.
I mean, I blame Greifeld for a lot of this.
You should. Well, I think you really should.
The Nasdaq, remember 1999?
I do remember that.
You let these stocks get totally
out of hand.
I personally did
technology.
That.
Well,
I'm going to apologize right now.
Do tech stocks not get way out ahead of themselves? Regardless, doesn't that happen?
Certainly the vast majority, but from that wreckage, there were some great companies.
There were.
Yeah.
But I do think, you remember how long it took us to get back to 5,000 on that? We used to call our building, we built a beautiful facility out in Englewood Cliffs, the Nasdaq 5,000 building.
Yep.
It was what's this then?
The top.
What is it?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure. This has got to portend something, I think.
This is a great home for CNBC.
It is.
Right? Just leave it at that.
Yeah, and we appreciate it. Even Tom Farley comes in here now, the former NYSE guy, and realizes the power, I think, of the NASDAQ. He sort of.
I don't think I heard him quite say that.
No, he didn't. But he didn't. That's not exactly. No, but
close.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Reading between the lines.
We're going to get to you and talk about all kinds of interesting stuff in a second. But just in terms of, I mean, I'm serious about the NASDAQ to some extent. That sometimes you do see the speculation get centered or focused on that.
Well, I would say in the last couple of years, more speculation on Bitcoin than on equities, excessive speculation. So you don't see what you saw back in 1999. And certainly the quality of the companies coming to market today are dramatically different than they were back in the late 90s, right? I think to make any comparison is
I agree with that, but if you look at the big drop in terms of the FANG stocks and some of the tech stocks that are based here.
And the move up,
that's where
and the move down, yeah.
Yeah, but I'd also say with the FANG stocks, you've got to look at it with a finer comb because some of them trade at a relatively low multiple of earnings and others do not. So I hate, that's a catchy
FANG
phrase.
You're like the most profitable companies in the world. Actually.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, what is Apple's multiple right now?
It's never been high.
Right, other stocks have higher multiples. So I think that grouping gives you kind of a false sense of unity of the stocks.